अस्सलाम वालेकुम व्यूअर्स, आई एम समीउल्लाह खान एंड यू आर वाचिंग लैंग्वेज टीवी। व्यूअर्स, और टुडेज़ टॉपिक इज़ बायोग्राफी ऑफ रॉबर्ट ब्रोनिंग। रॉबर्ट ब्रोनिंग वॉज अ फेमस विक्टोरियन पोइट एंड प्ले राइट ऑफ द 19th सेंचुरी। द इंग्लिश पोइट रॉबर्ट ब्रोनिंग इज़ बेस्ट नोन फॉर हिज ड्रामेटिक मोनोलॉग्स बाई विविडली पोर्ट्रेइंग अ सेंट्रल करेक्टर अगेंस्ट अ सोशल बैकग्राउंड। These poems explore complex human motives in a variety of historical periods. Robert Browning was born on May 7, 1812 in Camberwell, London, England. His father, a senior clerk with the Bank of England, provided a comfortable living for his family and passed on a love of art and literature to Robert. His mother, an excellent pianist, gave him a love of music, while her strong and simple religious faith provided him with a lifelong belief in the existence of God. Robert was a bright child, creating masterpieces of jam and pencil at the age of 2 and attending day school as an infant. Browning went to primary school until he was 14, when his parents decided that he should be sent neither to a public nor a private school, but should instead be taught at home by a tutor. His training included riding, fencing, boxing, singing and dancing along with the basics. The Brownings were a small, close-knit family, and Robert spent much time reading in his father's library of over 6,000 to 700 volumes. His father, Robert Browning Sr., was a clerk in the Bank of England. His mother name was Sarah Ann Widman. His mother was great committed Christian and a superb musician. Robert Browning wrote poem for Wordsworth. The poem name was The Lost Leader. Robert Browning was a talented child. He composed his first poem at the age of 12 years. During the early years of his age, he was educated at home. Browning had learned Latin, Greek, French and Italian by the time he was just 14. He got admission in London University in 1828 but left it within a year to become a poet. He was famous for his dramatic monologue and also called father of dramatic monologue. He was inspired or influenced by Shelley and Wordsworth. Browning's career began as a poet with the anonymous publication of the long poem Pauline, a fragment of a confession, in 1833. Though Browning later called the poem a failure, it received favorable reviews and brought about important friendships with the author William Wordsworth and Thomas Carlyle, and with the actor William C. Macready. Encouraged by these friends, Browning began to emerge in the London social scene. Encouraged by Macready, Browning turned to writing drama, but his first play, Stratford, which was published in 1837, closed after only 5 performances. During the next 10 years, he wrote 6 other plays, none of which were successfully produced. All of Browning's plays are marred by abundant character analysis and meager dramatic action. In 1838, Browning travelled to northern Italy to acquire first-hand knowledge of his setting and atmosphere for his next long poem. But the publication of Sordello in 1840 was a disaster that dealt Browning's groaning reputation a severe blow. Critics anonymously declared the poem totally unclear and unreadable, and modern readers still find it difficult. Pauline was followed by Paracelsus and Sordello. All three of these early works met with negative criticism. His wife Elizabeth Barrett was a respected and popular poet, and 6 years older than Browning, admired him in one of her works. Their first meeting was held in 1845. They fell in love and in 1846 eloped to Italy, where they spent the remainder of their life together. Their son, Rupert Bidman Barrett Browning, was born in 1849. The question is why he married Elizabeth Barrett. After reading Elizabeth Barrett's flattering reference to him in her poems, Browning wrote to her in January 1845. At that time, Barrett was an invalid confined to her room by a nervous disorder. The two became frequent correspondents nonetheless, and on May 20, 1845, Browning made his first personal visit. With his constant urging, she gained steadily in strength, hope, and will until she agreed to a secret marriage on September 12, 1846. Such secrecy was necessary because Barrett's father had forbidden all of his children to marry. Shortly after their marriage, the Brownings left London for Italy, and they made Casa Guidi in Florence their home from 1847 until 1861. It was there that their son Robert Whitman Barrett Browning was born on March 9, 1849. Elizabeth died in 1861. After the death of his wife, Browning and his son returned to England. The reason of Elizabeth's death was gradually declining in health for several years. Browning found that he could no longer remain in Florence because of the memories it brought forth. He resolved to go to England and live and work and write. In 1864, he published Dramatis Personae. Though some of the dramatic monologues in the collection are complex and difficult or overlong, this was the first of Browning's work to become popular with the general reading public. His popularity increased with the publication of The Ring and the Book in 1868 to 1869. The Ring and the Book was enthusiastically received by the public, and Robert Browning became an important figure in London society. He was a frequent guest at dinners, concerts, and receptions. In the next 10 years, Browning wrote with great energy, publishing a volume almost every year. But none of these works match the quality of Men and Women and Their Little Read today. Now we talk about his works in a bullet. Pauline, A Fragment of Confession, published in 1833. Pauline has impact of Shelley and based on introspection. Paracelsus, published in 1835. Strafford is play and published in 1837. Sordello has theme of art and life. Sordello consists of a fictionalized version of the life of Sordello da Goito, a 13th century Lombard troubadour depicted in Canto 6 of Dante's Allegries. Sordello has multi-layered meanings and many literary and historical allusions. On publication, the work was considered obscure and was a critical failure. Sordello is a study in the psychology of genius and the development of a soul, based on the renowned 13th century poet and troubadour of their name. The poem reveals the troubles of its subject, who is torn between the practical and the sublime, between the demands of his poetic imagination and his involvement in the power and glory of politics. After Sordello, Robert Browning published Dramatic Lyrics in 1842. One of the most important poems in Dramatic Lyrics was My Last Duchess, and his theme is money-making. After that, Dramatic Romances, published in 1845. Dramatic Romances consist of many poems, but we talk about just two important poems. The Last Leader is about Wordsworth. The Laboratory is about true incident. A female scientist commits suicide after killing her family. His another work, Bells and Pomegranates, consists of 8 volumes containing poems and plays, published in 1846. Christmas Eve and Easter Day, published in 1850. His work Men and Women, published in 1855. Men and Women, dedicated to his wife Elizabeth Barrett. Dramatis Personae, which was published in 1864, consists of many poems, but we talk about two important poems, Rabi bin Azra. Who is Rabi bin Azra? A mathematician, and his real name was Abraham ibn Izra. Caliban upon Setebos was another important poem in Dramatis Personae. It deals with Caliban, a character from Shakespeare's The Tempest, and his reflection on Setebos, the brutal god believed in by himself and his late mother, Sycorax. Browning's work, The Ring and the Book, published in 1868 or 1869. This work, considered a magnum opus of the Brownings, a long dramatic narrative poem. What is The Ring and the Book? A long narrative dramatic poem, and more specifically a verse novel. The Ring and the Book consists of 21,000 lines and 4 volumes. The book tells the story of a murder trial in Rome in 1698, whereby an impoverished nobleman, Count Guido Franceschini, is found guilty of the murders of his young wife Pompilia and her parents, having suspected his wife was having an affair with a young cleric. His another work, Fifine at the Fair, published in 1872, Dramatic Ideals, published in 1879. Dramatic Ideals, second edition, was published in 1880. Features of Browning poetry. Browning is now popularly known for such poems as Porphyria's Lover, My Last Duchess, How They Brought the Good News from Kent to Aix, and The Pied Piper of Hamelin. Browning wrote poems that are partly lyrical and partly dramatic, called the dramatic monologues. The monologues were used before him to express the thoughts and feelings of the poet himself. But Browning used his dramatic monologues to explore other men's character. What is dramatic monologue? Dramatic monologue, Browning's early poetry, is influenced by the works of the Romantic poets, particularly Shelley. Browning is a master in using dramatic irony, in which the audience or reader is aware of something of which the speaker is not aware. Love for the grotesque. His love for the grotesque takes him unique. He always explores uncommon psychological behaviors. Most of his protagonists are psychopaths. Browning presents death as a factor that frames our life choices. In the age of pessimism, Browning is full of optimism. One of his quotes was, "The aim, if reached or not, makes great the life." He gives a message of spiritual development. His philosophy is that humans do not have a fixed perspective. Every person sees the world differently under different circumstances, and the truth is subjective. Browning's poetry has rhythm but lacks in melody. What is rhythm? A strong, regular, repeated pattern of sounds or movements. Unlike his contemporary Tennyson, who is praised for the melody of his verses, Browning's poetry is conversational in tune. His profound thoughts make Browning difficult to understand. We further explain dramatic monologue. A dramatic monologue is a lyrical poem uttered by a single speaker at a critical moment of his life, but he is not the poet himself. The speaker of the monologue addresses and interacts with one or more listeners, but the listeners do not say or do anything. Their presence is inferred from clues in the monologue. The speaker presents his arguments to defend his past actions, but the focus is on his temperament and character that he inadvertently reveals through his or her own words. Browning died at his son's home in Venice, Italy, on December 12, 1889. In the epilogue to his last collection of lyrics, Browning described himself as one who never turned his back but marched breast forward, never doubted clouds would break. He was buried in Westminster Abbey. Please subscribe our channel and wait for next lecture. Alan Egebon.